In my family, there's a divide, a gap. Not the generation gap that us children of the 60s admitted. That gap exists between the last great generation, those who lived and fought in World War II, and the baby boomers. We used war in Vietnam as televised, the divide in our family. Between Harley, who was born July 12, 2000, and Kyle, who was born February 5, 2003, that divide is a day in our country. What day is that? September 11, 2001, 9/11, a day that changed our country and our way of life. When Harley was born, the World Trade Center still existed. We were still there physically. Now, she doesn't remember that because she's only 14 months old when they went down. But think about that. That day that changed so many lives, that changed our country forever. She was born when there were no physical threats to our personal security were less and not in our homes or schools or our churches. Her life, our lives were changed by that day forever. She's had to adjust by having to go through security lines to get her a concert, the zoo, Cedar Point, having school lockdowns. Think about that. Our lives changed in that certain way on that day, that divide. Now, Kyle's always done this. He's never known anything else than that. It's normal for him. We have all had life-changing events in our lives, so big and national, like Pearl Harbor, JFK's assassination, more personal, like birthdays, marriages, the death of family members, some less dramatic, like cell phones, right? The internet, cable, satellite, TV, but change or divide between what was and what is now. And Christ represents a divide. Jesus had issues with the established old ways and the way he represents. He argued with the Pharisees and the Sadducees. These, along with the Essenes, were the main religious groups of his era. The Pharisees were the common people of the day, the blue-collar people. They believed in the oral law of Moses and the Torah, the written law. Their interpretation of that oral law, their traditions, is what Jesus argued about with them until the last week's today's gospel lesson. They believed that they could clean their way into heaven, that by following rules, they could get into heaven. And Jesus says, don't you know, it's not what we take into us that defiles us, but what comes out of our mouths, out of our hearts that defiles us. He also disagreed with the Sadducees. Now the Sadducees were the elitist priesthood. These are the guys in charge of the temple. These are the guys that lived by themselves. They had their own entry into the Temple Mount area. They were separate from the people. It's like if we come up on a Sunday, we talked about this a little bit last week. We have a sidewalk on the west side of the church. The pastor used to walk on that sidewalk into this door up here. He was the only one allowed to do that. So think about this. We have divisions about what we're allowed to do. The pastor gets to stand up here. He's the only one. He gets to approach the altar. The acolytes get to approach the altar. The women of the church get to go up there and change the accoutrement of the altar. They're the only ones allowed to do that. A separation between most people and the holy people, between God and us. Now, the history of this is, when Moses is in the desert with his people, leading them through the desert, the people come to him and say, listen, we're afraid of God. They see this bright, colored pillar of flame, cloud of darkness, light. They say, we want something between us and God. So Moses goes to God and says, we've got a problem here. We want separation. God says, well, I'll give you your brother Aaron as a high priest. The high priest gets to do the Day of Atonement. He gets to do all these things to allow us to cleanse us from sin. And Christ comes along and says, listen, I'm the way, I'm the fulfillment thereof. Through me is heaven. Through me is salvation. Now remember, the Sadducees do not believe in the physical resurrection. They don't believe in what the Pharisees believe. And the Essenes are met of both Pharisees and Sadducees. They think these guys have corrupted not just Jerusalem, but the Temple Mount. So they're off by themselves in the desert. Again, when I say about the mikveh, that ritual bath, that ritual cleansing everybody has to go through to get into the temple, existed. And one of the things about that ritual bath is it cleansed them spiritually, they thought. It cleansed them so they could approach the Temple Mount. Now, archaeologists have done studies of the sediment of that bath, and guess what they found? They found parasitical remains. I mean, when these guys went into that bathtub, they might have been ritually pure, but they pass diseases on to one another. When I say I want to be the first person to do that bathroom before I come in the church, that's why. It's why when we talk about what comes out of us that defiles us, if I sneeze right now, it probably means my allergies are acting up. I'm not passing any germs to anybody. Now, germs can be good, germs can be bad. When we talk about germs, we talk about the bad germs. Now, scientists have done a study of the human biome. What's inside our guts, we need certain germs to live healthy. And what our society has done with the hand cleanser and all that stuff is we're killing off not just the bad germs, we're killing off the good germs we need to live. A division of physical, a division of spiritual. Christ is very good about taking that physical reference, that cleanliness, the hand washing, and saying, that doesn't matter. What matters is what comes out of us. As a Rotarian, we do projects, and we have a test, and we do projects, and we say, of the things we think, say, or do. Sound familiar? But what comes out of us is what drives us. What we say drives us. What we do represents evil. So what comes out of us is what defiles us. Not just our physical appearance. Well, that's important. It's not washing hands. It's important too. But what defiles us is what we think, say, or do. What we do, what comes into our heart is what defiles us. It's what this sin is about. And Christ is saying to the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and the Essenes, physical appearance, physical rules, the separation, we have all these rules and regulations to keep us from sinning, we think, is not the problem. The problem is what we think. We have this establishment, we have the rules and regulations that were very important. The Jews at the time, they needed those rules to set them apart, but also to make them understand they had to obey God. God was clean. He allowed no sin in His presence. You think about Christ on the cross, and God is not answering His Son, because His Son is defiled by Christ, by our sins. He has to go through the 3 days, the cleansing, the resurrection, before He can be God's presence again. The one day of the year, the high priesthood, they go into the inner temple mountain, they have to go through all the purification rituals. If you have a skin disease like leprosy, you're not allowed in the camp. You're outside the camp until you're that the state is cleaned by this priesthood. So we go into that. He argues with them about this literal interpretation they have about everybody being able to be the priest, and not everybody needs to be the priest. What were restrictions on diet, cleanliness, separation, these groups that by focus upon the physical led them closer to God. They thought that, believed that. Jesus said bluntly, it's the spiritual corruption that separates us from God, that divide. The pools used for ritual purification, again, they found traces of contamination in those pools. Jesus tells the Pharisees, do you not see that whatever goes into a person from outside cannot defile him, since it enters not his heart, but his stomach, and is expelled? Because what comes out of a person defiles him. So we talk about cold season coming up, if I sneeze, I should cover my hand, my mouth and my hand, because I can pass the germs on, with bad germs on. Now, several years ago, I used to say I never got a flu shot because I don't get the flu. Anybody ever say that? Everybody ever say, don't get the flu shot because you get sick? I had a discussion with my doctor about that. He said, it's not the flu shot that gives you a flu. You get a reaction to the flu sometimes. But think about this. If you have the flu and you spread it to 100 people, 3 of them are going to die. If I have a flu, if I'm out to the world, and I spread those germs, I contaminate 100 people, 3 of them are going to die. What does that make me? You want to be associated with somebody like me. And that's the reality of the flu of that period of time. So I don't know what the mortality rate is for any particular flu, any period of time, but wherever it is, if you have a flu you spread around, you're going to kill someone. That's reality. And what comes out of us that defiles us. Now, that's the physical realm. That defiling, that thoughts that come out of our hearts, out of our minds, that we say is what condemns us to Christ. If we are to represent Christ, we are to be pure in thought, word, and deed. And that's the struggle we all have every single day of our lives. That's the struggle that we come here to this hour of praise and worship today. That we need this praise, this hour of worship and praise to cleanse us internally. We need to understand that through Christ we can be cleansed of sin. Because for the 167 hours a week, we're out in the world, okay? We can't avoid that. The pressures of the world are upon us. We cannot ever avoid that. But can we live our lives in such a way that what's inside of us that reflects the glory of Christ, the resurrection, our baptism, our acceptance of Christ as our Lord and Savior, reflect that into the world? Can we take that with us the rest of the week? And that's what we're challenged to do. That's the divide between our physical selves, our spiritual selves, and we have to live that way. That struggle we do every single day, every minute of the day, that separates us from the world. We can be in the world, but we don't have to be of the world. If we take that divide that Christ represents, that bridge that crosses over from the spiritual, from the physical to the spiritual with us in our lives, and that's what we're demanding to do. Once we become baptized in His name, once we take communion, once we take that spiritual journey, that we reflect that spiritual journey into our physical world, that we live our lives in such a way that we reflect the glory of God. That's what we're called to do. And that put Christ that's across that divide between the physical and the spiritual side. So often in His teachings, He uses a physical thing to talk about spiritual life reality. Our physical lives, our earthly lives, we have to live. We can be in that world, but we don't have to be out of that world. The other thing I can think about is, I once gave blood, and on the blood list it says, have you spent more than 3 months in Great Britain? If I want to give blood to somebody to save their lives, well, I put down, yes, I've been more than 3 months in Great Britain because of mad cow disease, I can't give blood. I can't save somebody's life because of what's inside of them. There is that reality. So what we do, Jesus is adamant. It's not what, it's what we think the Savior that defiles us, that divides us from God. That's the divide between our physical self, our spiritual self. How do we bridge that divide between our carnal and our spiritual sides? We have wants and needs. We have a nice home. We want a nice home. A good job, a happy marriage, well-behaved children, do good in school. We pray, we ask God for healing and to provide us for what we think we want. But as we gather together today as a congregation, we move beyond our wants and come to accept what we need. The opening prayer allows us to start to focus on the service. The opening hymn guides us through music and words to our spiritual side. The liturgy, the prayer, the sermon help us to focus on knowing and accepting for Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior. We go from our wants to accept what God knows we need. This time of praise and worship guides us to accept this gift of the Holy Spirit that renews the right spirit within us. It helps us to cleanse us from our sinful self. It enables us to take our faith into the world to share the good news of the gospel with the world. Being centered on Christ allows us to bridge the divide between our physical to embrace Christ's redemption of our souls. We are in the world, we choose not to be of the world. That separation between Harley and Kyle can be bridged. Harley, by understanding and accepting the demise of the World Trade Center buildings. We were just there in New York 2 last week and saw New York City. It was amazing to me because we took our oldest granddaughters to New York City and they wanted to see where the World Trade Center was. Harley and Kyle didn't make care about that at all. They wanted to go to Coney Island. Now we saw the World Trade Center. That's a beautiful building. But it exists where the World Trade Center was. Harley's life was defined by the World Trade Center being torn down. Our lives changed that day in so many more ways. Like going to the zoo, you have to have your purse scanned, checked. You have to go through a body scan to go to the club zoo. That's the reality of the life we live in today. Schools get locked down. I don't remember ever getting schools locked down. That's the change, that divide. Christ represents the physical, divided between the physical and the spiritual. He challenges the Pharisees in saying that it's not what you take in, it's not the rules you follow, it's what spiritually comes out of you that you follow. These buildings, designed and built by man, they're not going to last. Now, I'm giving you that the Romans have built some mighty things. The pyramids are still there. Some incredible buildings built are still here in our time, 2,000 years later, but they're still going to come down. They're still running what the fading away. The internal defects of what caused the World Trade Center to come down, they've done the studies, and so those planes hit, the planes inside, there's no internal structure to hold those two buildings up. The external is what caused that to collapse. So now they think they built a better design building. If you're in California, when you build a building, it has to be earthquake proof. It has to meet certain standards. So, man can only build so good. Man can only do what man can do. He's not capable of being like Christ. He's not capable of that perfection. So the security lines will now go through hell to protect us. How can accept that there is now a new single building where there exists the two buildings? We have the picture, we have the film. We can prove that happened. Except for Photoshop. Photoshop can make things appear that never worked here. So the Pharisees and Sadducees rejected the change that Jesus represented to the world as they understood it. Their rules, their laws, traditions, and that he fulfilled that law. God had given them the word and oral laws that by following them, Israel would represent the glory of God to all nations. Now again, once we accept Christ as our Savior, once we become spiritually involved, once we get the Holy Spirit, our internal laws should be reflected by the things we do. Now the things we do won't save us, but they can reflect the glory of God. They failed, they came up short, they became a part of the world they lived in. Jesus rejected those traditions and was sent to redeem all of us through his life, death, and resurrection. Have you closed that divide between our earthly self and our spiritual by accepting Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Remember, we are to write the law on our hearts so that we become the light unto the world that our God, our Father,